So as we have more people joining, it's good to be in Pincher. We love this community. Now, that love aside, you're participating in this program because you went through an application process, of which I step back. Because we're trying to prove some things with this provincial initiative. We're going to talk today about the importance of social profit, service club, and nonprofit organizations in building a thriving community. But before we do that, I have to give you a little bit of framework.
Come on in.
I used to be in the casino business, and so I don't like my back to the door. Just so you guys know, I'm not excited about that. I keep looking over my shoulder. So this provincial initiative actually Pincher, to some degree, helped build. Because as some of you may know, my family and I were involved in a project up at St. Michael's School where they built a playground and a fitness park and so many cool things, and some of you were involved in that. That playground initiative and philanthropic endeavor called Let Them Be Kids was really about trying to solve a problem. How do we keep rural communities relevant in the 21st century? Now, I believe that rural communities are relevant in the 21st century. I believe if Canada is to reach its full potential, rural communities play a vital part of that. All 34 million people cannot live in 10 cities. How many of you would concur? However, rural communities face significant, real, and profound barriers in the 21st century. And there are a lot of people and a lot of money being spent on trying to overcome those barriers. So Let Them Be Kids was about playgrounds and skate parks and fitness parks. That's true. And Let Them Be Kids was about creating community gathering spaces. But Let Them Be Kids was really, underneath all that, about building community capacity, growing up grassroots leaders, providing them a real-world learning experience to hone their leadership skills. Take a bunch of informal leaders, give them some skill, give them some support, and then get out of their way, and we bet they could do great things. And we know that in this community, some great things happened. And those same great things happened in some 160 communities as we tested this thing. From Twillingate, Newfoundland, to Hay River, the Northwest Territories, from Vancouver to Crystal Beach, Ontario, and all points in between. In Alberta specifically, about 17 communities we philanthropically supported through that program. But the whole time we were doing it, we had an ulterior motive. The ulterior motive was, what were the leadership approaches that were working today? Because the leadership approaches of the past may not work today. How many would agree with me we're in changing times? Changing times, there's no doubt. Which, since we know we're in changing times, logic would dictate that the way we've done it in the past may not and probably won't work today. So those projects said to us, this is what works. This is how you get people off their big fat couch. How many of you are part of organizations that you would like to see some people come and be a part of what you're doing and get off their big fat couch? Any pastors in the room? Because I was going to say something else, so I toned that down. Okay, pastor, I'm toning that down. Pastor in the room, got to have a little fire insurance, but tone that down a little bit. You know, how do you get them off their big fat couch? Well, we found a way. People were getting off their big fat couch. In hundreds. We just did a project in Port Hawkesbury, Nova Scotia, 2 weekends ago. 500 people showed up. They raised $163,000 in 100 days. In a community where the shipbuilding plant had just closed. How crazy is that? So we knew these techniques worked. We marshaled human capital. People gave their time, talent, treasure, energy, passion, insight, wisdom, love. They gave it. These leadership approaches work. So we started to glean those approaches and lay them out in a sequential curriculum that could be shared with others in a meaningful educational experience. But then somebody said, well, wait a minute. It's the playgrounds. That's what it is. It's like a barn raising. It's the barn raising of the 21st century. That's why it works. And we said, okay, maybe. That could be true. So let's try it on something else. So we took 23,000 people, and tried the curriculum in the business sector, in the social profit sector. I don't say nonprofit. I say social profit sector. Because they are profitable to our community. Right? They're not nonprofit. You're not defined by what you're not. You're defined by what you do. You provide social profit. So it's not nonprofit, social profit. Governmental entities. Literally 23,000 people all across North America, all the way to Lismore, Australia. And it worked again. You didn't have to have a playground. Businesses became more profitable. Governmental entities were more effective and made greater impact. Volunteer sector organizations and social profit organizations recruited more volunteers, and they stayed. They got more done with less. It worked again. Then, through a unique series of circumstances, and whether you believe in the hand of divine providence or cosmic coincidence, either way, whatever you want to call it, a unique set of circumstances took me to Fort McMurray. I was invited by the community. And they asked me what should be done. And I said, let's try this thing. Let's try to prove the following, that people closest to the problem are best at solving their problem, and that an all-out commitment to the growth of informal community leaders will take the leaders to the next level and take the community to the next level. So two thoughts here. If you want to solve the rural community challenge of today, then one, know that the people closest to the problem are most likely to solve the problem. Their solution is usually cheaper, makes a greater impact, and sustained longer. How many of you agree? It's rarely the guy in some building far, far away on the 22nd floor that solves your problem. And whether that building is in Edmonton or Ottawa, and that's not a political stance, that's just a logical stance. The guy or gal who lives there every day probably knows it a little bit better. Just like the teller at the ATB probably knows vocationally a little bit better than you.
True story.
And if I, when I asked them at Timmy's this morning, they said I was right. No, they didn't. So, and then the second premise, all-out commitment to informal leaders. Now, what does that mean? Most of your organizations that you represent, and you're sitting here in this room, you rely. Your lifeblood is informal leaders, right? For most of you. Ag society, you know, any of your social clubs, any of your service clubs, even the faith institutions that are represented, informal leaders. In the 283 communities that I've been in the last 5 years across the country, Shashashi Labrador, how many of you have been to Shashashi? Right? I've been to Shashashi Labrador. You say, you live a pretty exciting life. Yeah. Shashashi Labrador, or any of those communities, the defining factor, the quality or capacity of informal leaders. When the informal leadership capacity was high, great things were getting done. Where the informal leadership capacity was low, things weren't getting done. They had their little fiefdoms, their little hills, they didn't know how to work together, they couldn't unite around a common goal, there were petty differences, nothing was happening, and everybody in the community was paying the price. Where there was high leadership capacity, what is that? Leadership excellence in all sectors, in all silos, in all nooks and crannies of the community. Where community leadership capacity was high, people were innovating, people were creating, people were collaborating, they were problem solving, they didn't care who got the credit, they were all marching to a common goal of building a community that all would want to live in. How many of you know in your own personal experience those two things to be true? So I would suggest to you, it's not about elected officials. No offense to anyone in the room, it's either unelected official or...
Twice.
That's right. Or is aspiring to be one. Listen, I've seen communities where there's great elected officials, but the informal leaders couldn't lead themselves out of a paper bag, and the community falls, stumbles, trips. I've also seen where you have incompetent, and I mean that in love, elected officials who were good-hearted, well-meaning people, but couldn't lead. Because how many of you know good-hearted, well-meaning people screw things up every day? You got to be a good-hearted, well-meaning, equipped person to get something done today. So I've seen situations where the formal leaders just couldn't lead. And yet, that was overcome because you had great leadership capacity in the faith community. You had great leadership capacity in the social profit community. You had great leadership capacity in the business community. You had great leadership in the service clubs. And they all worked together. So it didn't matter. And frankly, how many of you know, all of those people setting the culture of the community has significant influence on the formal leaders. Yes or no? So is it about formal leaders or informal? I'd say it's about informal. So this thing in Fort McMurray, they said, we need to grow leadership capacity. We have great leadership capability, we just don't have enough. So we took all that curriculum, we took everything we learned, and we rolled it out for free, had first initially 500 participants and then 933 participants in a 15-week leadership development program. And the only thing we asked in return from them was this: go build a better community. We've given freely to you. We've enhanced your life and bettered your life. Now go. Go build a better community. And it was tremendous success. Well, my belief is that Alberta is a defining, and I'm going to use Alberta as a community, all of Alberta as one community. I think you could be the defining community of the 21st century. You're drunk. Not anymore, Pastor. There wasn't. Fire insurance. There you go. Let me unpack that really quick. I think history will judge Alberta. I think history will look back on you and say, you had more resources than can last three lifetimes. Am I right or wrong about that? You have more talent. Talent is pouring into this place from all over the world. Now, you may not like that, I don't know. But I'll tell you this. Talent is pouring into this place from all over the world. The word Alberta is on every business lip around the globe. People would kill for the opportunity that Albertans have. And history will judge you. So you have resources, you have talent, and you have opportunity. What will you do with it? You could be a beacon of hope of what communities could look like in the 21st century, or not. And 100 years from now, what will people say? And I think you, all of you, that are about community, play a role in that. So Pincher in Nanton, Lacombe County in Strathmore, Consort, Bonneville, High Level, all of these little communities can approve something. Rural communities are relevant, and we know how to get it done. And then that beacon of hope will shine to Twillingate, Newfoundland, shine to Port Alberni, BC. And because there's so many people in the province from around the world, via Twitter and Facebook and instant message, they'll tell people back home, this is how you build a community. Now, you may not have the capacity to believe that that could be possible. You may have become so jaded and so crusty that you don't think tomorrow can be better than yesterday. Okay, I'm good. Maybe. Not me. I believe tomorrow can be better than yesterday. You know how I know? I'll tell you why. Because there's a couple people in the room that had a dream and they made it come true. Now, you may like or not like St. Michael's, whatever, I don't care. I mean, there's all kinds of factions in Pincher. Am I just talking real now or what? But I know this. I know a bunch of people came around a common goal and made something happen in a short period of time. I live that all the time. So I know tomorrow can be better than yesterday. So I know that this thing can be a beacon of hope to others of what could be in the 21st century. That's what we're doing. So your community was selected to participate. In what? You get to equip yourself for free. 15 weeks of comprehensive leadership development. You're the heart of the community. You pump the lifeblood through any community. When the heart of a human is strong, how many of you know it? Health. When the heart is weak, when the heart is discombobulated, you know, the veins and the arteries are clogged and stuffed and it doesn't flow right. How many agree with me? Challenge. The heart of the community. And frankly, the heart of the community, your sectors, your organizations, are what make a community worth living in. You make a community worth living in. The business group that I talked to a minute ago, they pump the fuel into the engine. But you make the community worth living in. The challenge is, are you a good-hearted, well-meaning person? Or are you a good-hearted, well-meaning person that's equipped? Equipped for what the times require. How many of you are frustrated because you can't get people to participate in your thing? Raise your hand if you're frustrated with the amount of volunteerism. You know why? I'll tell you why. Because most of you are probably utilizing a recruitment and retention strategy from days gone by. You're working probably off of an obligatory mindset. You see, it used to be people would give you their time, talent, and treasure because they were obligated to do so. Some of you remember a day when it wasn't even a choice. You gave time. You gave money. You gave effort. Because if you didn't, the community died. And before that, your grandparents knew they literally would die. It There was no volunteerism. It was called survival. So, you put in some time, I put in some time, and frankly, I might not even like you. But the edges were a little softer because I might need food from you this winter. So I wasn't so pointy. How many of you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
All of a sudden we get sophisticated, we think we can make it on our own, so we all get a little pointy. Because we don't understand that I do need you. There is a symbiotic relationship. I am my brother's keeper. That's pretty good, Pastor, huh? Yeah. Pastor's like, this guy can preach. That sermon will hunt, right? Listen now. So many nonprofits, social profit, service club, and other organizations in the quality of life sector are still working off the obligatory recruitment strategy, which is, don't you see, you're supposed to help. Don't you know, it's just what we do. And how many of you know, somewhere along the line, citizenry shifted to this. Prove to me that your thing's worth my time. Prove to me that your thing is worth my energy. Prove to me that your thing is worth my treasure. How many agree with me? Many of our citizenry have that mindset. Organizations are still working off the obligatory, which is, don't you see the value? Don't you understand the importance? Don't you realize you have a responsibility to help? And today's citizen says, actually, no, I don't see any of that. I've got other things to do. I've got my own life. Yeah, but what about community? I don't know. Isn't that the mayor's job?
Yeah.
Isn't that the public works department's job? That's what some people's mind. Now, I'm not making a value judgment. I'm trying to show you how times have changed. And if you're still working off of old recruitment and retention strategies, old engagement strategies, based on a time gone by, obligatory mindset, you will fail. And if you fail, the heart of the community has failed. And if the heart of the community fails, we will die. Community is not a group of people that live in close proximity to one another and share the buying and selling and consuming of goods together. That's not a community. How many of you would concur? But how many of you would agree with me? You've been in places that is the community. All that defines us is that we live near each other. You buy my stuff, I buy yours, services, product, whatever. And then we consume it together and we call that community. That's not community, and it won't sustain. So you as a social profit, faith, service club leader, board member, staff person, whatever, if you don't understand the leadership approaches the times require, we are sunk. Not you are sunk. We are sunk. Okay, Ian, well, how do you recruit volunteers? How do you get them in the game today? Well, I can only share with you what we've done with Let Them Be Kids. And we've now had literally thousands of people participate. So we came to a couple conclusions. First, we came to the conclusion that we were in changing times. Somebody tell me how have times changed. Give me some examples of how times have changed, besides this obligatory piece. How have times changed?
Everybody drives to town to play ball and not play in their local park.
Okay. So people don't stay that sense of neighbor community. Okay, what else? How many agree with this? That we are less trusting as a society than we've ever been in our lifetimes. Are we less trusting? How many of you agree with this? If you really want to engage a volunteer today, you have to understand that we're in a user-driven society. What's user-driven mean? Well, it means this. That means almost every institution that you interface with or any citizen interfaces with gives them either the impression or the reality that they have a say. Let's use the bank. I'm picking on you. 20 years ago, tomorrow afternoon at 4:58, what would all of us have been doing? Don't say scrambling to happy hour. Don't say that. What would all of us been scrambling to get to? The bank. Because he would close. And then he wouldn't open back up till Monday at 10. And then he'd close Monday at 3. What the heck he was doing the other time with my money, I don't know. Ian, you have banker issues. Yes. Now watch. Today, when can I get my money?
Anytime.
If I have any, I can get it in 495,000 locations. I can email money today. How would you say that's a fundamental shift? Where were the community gathering places of 50 years ago, 70 years ago, even 40 years ago, community gathering places. Where did we gather as community in the past?
Sports.
Church?
Sports.
Service club?
Coffee shop.
Coffee shop? How about this? How many of you say our own front porch, our own kitchen? Were these the community gathering places?
Branding.
How many agree with me that the community gathering places today are almost all commercially based? Fundamental shift. Fundamental shift. The institutions that used to build the citizen of tomorrow, the family, the church, the service club, the paternal or fraternal organizations that our parents were involved in, those institutions used to build the citizen of tomorrow. They instilled the qualities, the intangible qualities needed for a citizen to function in a free society. Would you agree with me that those institutions are fractionalized at best? Now we wonder who's building the citizen of tomorrow. All of these changes must be taken into consideration. It is the context that we're running our social profit service club organization in. There's no way they can carry the torch effectively and pass it on. Some of you know I've gotten to know a man here in this region named Hank.
Oh, yeah.
Hank Flanger. And last time I was here, a guy named Ron Schmidt took me to his house. His house has been standing for over 100 years. And I went out to Hank's house, and we sat in Hank's house and just talked over his little table there. And Hank told me about what it was like here when he was a kid. He told me, he legacied me. He legacied me. And I felt like, in a way, and maybe it wasn't, and maybe I'm being overly dramatic, I felt like it was like him handing me something. Him handing me something and saying, now look, this is what it was. Here's the essence of it. Here's the purity that it was. Now you take and you be a steward of it. So all of this stuff that I'm saying is rooted in a skill. It takes skill, a certain skill, to understand what you need and provide it. It takes certain skills to build recruitment and retention strategies and deliver them. It takes certain skills to know how to negotiate a use of a building and not do it in a zero-sum mentality where I win, you lose, and for me to win, you must lose. And for you to win, I must lose. How many of you know that zero-sum approach is passé and unsustainable? But if you've been doing things a certain way for 30 and 40 years, and then somebody comes along and says this, hey, you got to change. How many of you know that's a tough shift? That's why any educational program that you involve yourself in better be able to explain their behavioral change model. They better be able to tell you why they think your behavior will change. And it better be rooted in two things. 21 days to establish a habit. How many of you know that to be true? 21 days to establish a habit and a blended learning. Some of you in the room, you learn by hearing. Some of you in the room, learn by seeing. Some of you in the room, learn by talking. So this 15-week program looks to equip the informal leaders within the social profit sector so you can really have a healthy heart of the community. How are we going to do that? We take five competencies. Agent of change. You got to know how to change something today. If you don't know how to change anything, don't leave. Don't leave. If you don't know how to change something, don't leave. Because you have a moral obligation to take care of the people that are followers. And today is a time of rapid change. Which means if you don't know how to change something, you're going to make their life miserable. You're going to cause more stress, cost more money. So if you don't know how to change something effectively, don't leave. Or go learn how to change something. Agent of change. Secondly, systems thinking. Systems thinkers will rule the day. Oh, you mean computers? No. I mean systems. Holistic thinkers that see the big picture and can create little parts that impact the big picture. That system might be a system for delegation. That system might be a system for motivation. Or that system might be a system for recruiting and retaining volunteers. But are you a systems thinker? Because systems are force multipliers. I can do more with less with a good system. Archimedes was right. He said, give me a place to stand and I will move the world. Which sounds like he's talking about human capacity. He wasn't. He was talking about his fulcrum and lever. If I have a big enough fulcrum and a big enough lever, I can move a stone that I don't have the physical capacity to do on my own. How many of you don't have enough time, energy, or effort to get done everything you need to get done?
Oh, yeah.
You know what you need? Better systems. You need a great system. System for time management. A system for communication. Systems.
Mommy,
Catalyst for Responsibility. Today, you've got to be able to get others to take more ownership and responsibility and like it. That's the parenthetical, right? And like it. And then finally, effective planning. Yeah, I know what time it is, James. Jesus Christ, I got to watch. I love this guy. Already I love him. Man, he'll tell me. 30 seconds here. Like we're on live TV. We're in picture. Come on, I'll take my time. How many of you have been part of an organization that didn't have a good plan? Because we're in changing times, because the battle for the discretionary donation or resource dollar is more intense than it's ever been, we must have great plans. And whether they're mandated sustainability plans for our community, or whether they're just a plan for the event we're going to do tomorrow, we must be great planners. And I think planning, effective planning, is a skill. So those are the five competencies that we'll teach in this program. The program starts October 18th. It's free for everyone. Everybody can participate. So never again will a nonprofit, social profit organization in this town say, we don't have money for training. You can't ever say that. You can't ever say again, well, we can't train our board members. We can't train our volunteers. The high school students never again can say, I don't have access to quality leadership training to put in my portfolio. Never again. Your community will have this tool forever. What's the key right now? We've got to get as many people to sign up as possible. Why? So that you can all get on the same leadership song sheet. Right? Now, you might not agree with every principle I lay down, and that's cool. But I'll tell you this, you've got to be a systems thinker today. You might not like the systems we provide, that's cool, but go get some systems. You might not agree with our change models, but get a change model. You might not agree with our techniques to recruit and retain volunteers, but how many of you agree you need a technique? So you might not agree with the specific ones we laid down, but I guarantee you, you'll agree with the concepts. Here's the final thought. What if we did get, because right now I think we're at 60. We haven't really even launched the program. We're at 60 registrants. What if we just got 100? Let's just say we had 100 registrants from all different sectors and silos in the community, and they went on an educational journey together for 15 weeks. And this is a unique part of the program. We expect no financial. We aren't going to charge you, man, but you're going to pay. Because every participant is expected to make a commitment, a written commitment to me of what you're going to do to make your community a better place to live. So imagine if 100 people took that seriously, made a commitment, fulfilled that commitment, whether in their own personal growth, within their family, or within the community or organization. How many agree with me, by the 16th week, we'd have a better Pincher Creek? So that's the drill. That's what we're selling. But it's free. Raise your hand if you're on the committee. So these are the committee members. If you want more information, if you want to find out how to register, if you want to know how you can apply it into your organization, maybe your whole board will go through it together. In other communities, the whole board is going through it together. I don't have time. That's the beauty of this thing. You can follow along the 15 weeks, or you can do it at your own leisure. That's the beauty of the model. I don't have time to explain it. Talk to one of the committee members. I don't have time to explain it. You're the heart of the community. You make a community worth living in. When the heart is strong, the body is healthy. When the heart is weak, it literally now, it sucks energy from the rest of the body. When your heart is ailing in a human body, it literally sucks energy from everywhere else. When the quality of life sector is not strong, it sucks energy from the rest of the community and its resources. I thank you for being a part of the heart of the community. For those of you that are volunteers, thank you for your early mornings and your late nights. Thank you for your weekends and taking time from your own families to build better community. For those of you that are staff, thank you for your long years of commitment. People don't know the time and energy you put in. They don't know the seniors you help, the kids you help, the community you build. But I do, my wife and I do. And we thank you for your commitment to that as professionals.